time, all we can do is vote. We don't have to ask for objections.
All right, it is 11:40, the meeting is back to order. Now that we've handled, for what purpose does the member rise?
Adam Tesh, I'd like to make a motion to move the YA Hugo discussion up in the agenda.
To now?
Yes. No. To the item after the next item.
To the item after the, so you, we are currently,
yes, enough.
Yeah, we're currently at A or B.
B23.
So you'd like us to do B23 and then B211.
That is correct.
Is there a second for this motion?
A second.
Do we really need to debate this?
No.
All right, all those in favor of moving B211 to after B23, please raise your hands. Hands down. All those opposed?
Eyes have it.
The eyes appear to have it. The eyes do have it. We will handle B23, then B211. That means we are now on B23.
Thank you.
2 years are good enough. It is on page
10.
10. We have 10 minutes of debate for this. Mr. Buff, as the maker of the motion, would you like to speak in favor? And please, for the record, if you're using the microphone, do speak into the microphone and speak slowly. It will benefit both the members and the secretary.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Warren Buff. We are making this motion for a variety of reasons. Chief among them is that this has created a ton of administrative overhead to try and match the list of next year's Worldcon with this year's, when both lists are actively expanding. The number of new voters gained from this nearly 50 hours of work is down around 100-150 new nominators. So the gains are minuscule compared to the overhead on our administrators. The state we're asking to return to, current and previous year, is precisely the state that we had for nominations when I arrived in Worldcon fandom in 2008. This is a recent innovation. It's a recent innovation that we've found to be impractical from an administrative standpoint. And for those reasons, I'd like to see us reverse it. Thank you.
Is there a speech against the motion? Seeing none. Is there any objection to calling the question? Seeing none, I'm going to call the question. The question is on first passage of 2 years is good enough as written on page 10 of your agendas. All those in favor, please raise your hands. Hands down, all those opposed. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion passes and will be sent on to Worldcon 75. That brings us to B211, which is on page.
Nobody stood up to read the amendment.
We are on B211.
Page 27 on your song sheet.
27. Is Ms. Rask in the room? There. Would you like to make a speech in favor? Is 27.
The very bottom.
Can someone bring me an agenda, please? Thank you.
Can I just make a statement in general?
Thank you.
Okay, good. Yeah. I'll do that.
It's time for a speech in favor.
Oh, no, it was Linda who wanted one, and we got one.
No, she got it.
The secretary has an agenda. We're all set. Ms. Rask, a speech in favor. There are, for the record, 14 minutes of debate.
Hi, everyone. My name is Katie Rask. I am the chair of the YA Award Committee. I wanted to make a few statements in general before you guys really start debating. I know that it's been hard for everybody to read through this gigantic agenda we have, so I'll just make a few points. First of all, for those who were here yesterday, the Young Adult Committee was voted in again for next year. We will continue discussing some of these issues. I wanted to thank everybody for debating the proposal that we've put forward now. Most of our work this year was actually addressing the feasibility of an award, so we really do want to get your feedback on what you think of this proposal. So thank you all for debating that now. Just some of the details about the proposal that we have in front of you now. We didn't want to put any specifics of award administration into the Constitution, as this has come up repeatedly over the last few days. And as such, that's one of the reasons we do not have a definition of young adult in the award as you see it before you. There is a sunset clause for 3 years after ratification. I'd also like to point out the first provision to the insertion of the amendment, provided that filling the blank in this amendment to name the award shall not be considered a greater change in the scope of the amendment. We actually included this. I know that lots of people had ideas for names for an award of this type if it were to be passed. And we actually spent a lot of time discussing this as a committee, and we didn't include a lot of the details of that discussion because that would be something that next year's committee would address, because we found that it's actually a much more complicated issue than we tend to think. So we have a list of names possible for an award, but we also have a list of objects that would be possible names for an award in case there are some issues with picking an individual to represent the award. We would address all of this and research the logistics, the legal elements, the social elements associated with particular individuals or named topics. And we would present that all to the business meeting next year and make that public beforehand so the business meeting could vote on it or decide what they liked best. Okay, so I think that is all I have for you guys now, unless there are any questions.
Speech against Miss Secor.
Hello, everybody. I'm Kate Secor.
Talking to the mic.
Sorry.
It was taller yesterday. I'm not actually against the idea of a YA award. I'm very much in favor of a YA award and was, in fact, on the committee for the last 2 years. I object to this specific proposal because I actually think it's bad for YA. I have really sincere concerns, and I've talked to several authors who share those concerns, that creating a non-Hugo YA award actually ghettoizes YA. That it will prevent YA from ever appearing on the actual Hugo ballot. And honestly, there are a lot of authors that winning a Hugo-branded Hugo is actually really important to them. Like, they came up through fandom, the Hugo is the award that's meaningful to them. I have concerns that creating a separate award will prevent those authors, will make those authors feel like they could never win the award that they grew up feeling was so important, and now they're gonna win this other thing. And it'll be the Campbell and the Blink Award are not really Hugo, right? And it'll, that's sincerely my objection.
Is there a speech in
favor? In favor.
I'm gonna recognize the gentleman here.
My name is David Peterson. By the way, I'm 4230.
I just need your name.
Pardon?
I just need your name to just bring the badge up when you're done.
First, I wanted to say that, of course, we've also spoken to a number of YA authors, including a few YA authors that are here presenting at Worldcon, who, and all of those authors I've talked to have had exactly the same opinion. I think they think that it would be outstanding for there to be a Hugo Award for YA, but understanding the feelings of those who vote to put the Hugos on, they believe that a Campbell Award is not a bad solution. Not only that, I would like to just remind us that the committee, if I've got this year right, the first time that a YA Hugo was proposed was 25 years ago. And the award has come up again and again and again and been debated again and again and again and been defeated again and again and again. And I want to impress upon the voters now that we have heard your objections. And we are taking them very seriously, and we're trying our very best to get some sort of recognition for YA here at Worldcon. And this was our best compromise. So again, we hear you. We trust in your opinions, and we know that you care about the Hugos, and we do too. And so we think that this is the best alternative that we could propose. Thank you.
All right, a speech against Mr. Harris.
Excuse me, sir, can I get your badge for a second?
Colin Harris. I am actually, for the first time, having sat through however many iterations of the YA proposals, in favor of this proposal. However, I'm against it this year for one simple reason. It's already been pointed out that the name of the award has been left blank, and it's been clarified that should be seen as a lesser change. However, Ms. Rask also highlighted that some questions, such as the exact definition of the YA and how it might be administered, given that it's not a Hugo and will not automatically be handled the same way, are not yet finalised. I therefore foresee a problem. If we pass this now, we're potentially putting something into the Constitution, which greater changes are very likely to come up next year about that codification. And I'd rather see the complete proposal than go through tortuous delayed ratifications, et cetera, next year. So I would be against it just for now.
All right, speech in favor. I will recognize the gentleman here. Can the sergeant at arm?
Give him the mic.
Yes, I'm Mike Stern. And I would like to make a proposal for a lesser change. We all know who the Hugo is named after. I would like to call this the Gernsback.
Is there a second to the motion to amend by changing the title to the Gernsback Award? Seeing none, I will look for a speech in favor as that motion was. Mr. Barclay, are you rising for a speech in favor? No, that an amendment is by definition, or
was in the opposing slot.
So this is
in favor.
In favor.
Thank you, Chris Barclay. It's been a long time coming to at least this point, and I would like to thank
Chris. Can you?
I would like to thank Katie Rask, Warren Buff, Dave McCarty, and all the other committee members for doing all the work they have done over the past couple of years, even when I've been absent. I would also like to thank the loyal opposition, because you can never learn anything from people you always agree with. And while I'm honored this is on the floor, I urge people to please vote for this, even in an incomplete form. I believe it's the best way forward. I further urge that the members be mindful that this isn't about any individual. What we do here builds legacy. We build legacies by building things, not denigrating or destroying them. We got to move forward. And I'd like to thank everybody. Thank you very much.
Dr. Adams.
Dr. Andrew Adams, I'm not going to actually speak to the substance of this proposal. I'm going to speak to the situation in which it's coming forward. Our awards are currently under attack. That includes the Campbell Award. This is not a time to be adding new awards, particularly ones which are somewhat controversial within the community, because they will come under attack right from the beginning. Whether I feel this is a good award or not in the long term, I feel that this is the wrong time for us to be adding such an award, because the griefers will simply attack it along with the Hugos and along with the Campbell. And I think we'd be better delaying it until we have a solution to that before we add another award, particularly one that has some controversy within the community.
Mr. Buff, since...
Warren Buff. I asked you yesterday to help bring our awards closer to the state of the publishing art by recognizing series fiction. I ask you today to bring our awards closer to the state of the art of publishing by recognizing YA fiction. I have in the past opposed YA Hugos because I don't think that they're workable. I've been vocal in that opposition, but I joined the committee because I believed we could have a Campbell-like solution that would be the best way forward for actually recognizing the great work that goes on in YA while not creating an administrative nightmare of which category something goes into between best novel, best novella, and a best YA book, as this proposal does satisfy those needs, I encourage you to vote for it.
Mr. Olson, a speech against?
Mark Olson. The section about filling in the blank in this amendment being a not a greater change, am I correct that since this is not yet part of the Constitution, it cannot have any effect on next year's business meeting and consequently is null?
I believe that is correct.
Okay. May I make a speech?
We're against.
Great, thank you. The reason that I really am of two minds on this, I've been strongly opposed to
Mr. Olson, can you pause for, please do face the audience. We do have lip readers.
I'm trying to face that part of the audience. Oh. There's a whole audience out there. You know. I've been opposed to this motion.
Point of privilege, I'm trying to read the cart screen and you're standing in front.
Sorry. I've been opposed to this to a YA Hugo quite strongly. I actually think this is a pretty good solution. I also believe, however, with Colin is half-baked. It's almost certainly going to receive changes, if we pass it this year, almost certainly going to receive changes next year, which will be a greater changes. Certainly putting in a title is a greater change. I believe that we need an entirely baked solution so we can pass it and be done with it.
Speech in favor, Mr. Actually, you haven't spoken, so I'm going to recognize.
It's never tall enough for me. I'm Kat Faber, C-A-T. I don't understand the problem with the idea that we may have to pass a greater change next year. If we defeat the amendment this year, it's still 3 years before it passes, and it might not get proposed again because people are getting kind of discouraged, I think. So I would encourage you to pass it this year. If we have to make a major change, we'll make a major change, and it'll be 3 years, but it's not extra time.
Mr. Wallen, are you making a speech against?
There are 20 seconds in favor.
For the record, there are 20 seconds remaining in favor and like four minutes against.
Renee Walling. I'd rather have a fully baked solution. The greater amendment we would try to pass next year will be likely to not be as good as a fully baked solution.
Mr. Stanley, are you speech in favor? Yeah, so hustle up.
Kevin Stanley. Mr. Chairman, while I am skeptical of the overall proposal, I encourage the members to remember that the perfect is the enemy of the good. If we don't move forward now, I don't think we ever will move forward.
Mr. Breitbart, speech against? For the record, time in favor has virtually expired.
Seth Breitbart, while I'm in favor of the general idea of a young adult award, there is the problem that has been noted with this one, and therefore I move to add sunrise and sunset clauses so that we have a fully baked proposal at the time we pass and ratify it.
It has a sunset.
Yes, I wish to add sunrise clause then.
Is there a second for the motion? Does anyone wish to debate the motion or can we just vote on it?
One year.
So the motion is to, yes.
My idea was that the sunrise clause was intended to be added at the second year and not at the first year. So
it doesn't stop someone from doing it on the first year.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Cronengold, for what purpose does the member rise?
I wish to debate.
Okay. Mr. Breitbart, do you care to make a speech in favor? No, all right, Mr. Cronengold,
You have 5 seconds.
No, it's the
yes, it's dropped. Thank you.
Yes.
I would urge the member to hurry it up because we've got a lot still to go through. So
quite.
We haven't started timing.
Yeah.
I'm waiting till he speaks.
Please make your argument, Mr. Cronengold.
Absolutely. A sunrise clause is completely irrelevant and useless here. If we're going to make a greater change, that will automatically delay it. If we're not going to, then it won't.
All right. There's time in favor of the amendment.
Anyone who hasn't spoken yet?
Do we need to debate the amendment any further? Is there a second to calling the question?
Second.
Is there any objection to calling the question? Seeing none. The question is on the amendment to add a sunrise clause for 1 year. All those in favor of adding such a clause, please raise your hand. All right, hands down. All those opposed? The noes appear to have it. The noes have it. The amendment fails. Do we need to debate the underlying motion any further?
We can't.
We can have speeches against. Is there any objection to calling the question?
Yes.
All right. All those in favor of calling the question, please raise your hands. All those opposed? The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The question is called. The question is now on B.2.11, a young adult award. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hands. All right, hands down. All those opposed? The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion moves on to Worldcon 75. We are now back at B24.
Yep, three stage. Thirteen.
Page 12. We have 20 minutes of debate. Mr. Harris, would you like to make a speech in favor?
Which one are we doing now?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
This is a complex issue, as you understand. I also understand, having sat through 10 or 15 years of business meetings, we all get very tired by the third day, especially with all these diversions. Just ask everyone to take a breath and let's give this, and then tomorrow EPH, the respect and time and thought it deserves, because we are engaged in a very difficult set of challenges for the reputation and integrity of the Hugos. And we need to find the space and thought to actually deal with those challenges. I want to give plenty of people a chance to speak, so I'm going to keep my remarks concise. If you're not familiar with the motion, please read it. I don't propose to yield for questions at this time. In essence, we're proposing to insert a second stage in Hugo ballot between nominating and final. This will involve publishing the long list of 15, and people will be able to vote yes, no, or abstain on whether they believe each of those items is an appropriate candidate to be on the shortlist. Any candidate that is rejected by both having more no's than yeses and at least 600 or 20% of the total population of no's, so you need both a large absolute number and a majority against, would be excluded from consideration. Once you've excluded those people, the top five from the nominating ballot would go through under whatever counting scheme is in place, whether it's EPH or the current one. Why are we proposing this now, given all these other options are on the floor, EPH, 4 and 6 and so on? Essentially, it's very simple. We have to ask ourselves, what is our success criteria for the safe continuation of the Hugo Awards? It is becoming apparent that with things like EPH, we absolutely guarantee a couple of good candidates per category. The question is, do we believe that the integrity and reputation of the awards is preserved by having a couple of good candidates per category and two or three puppies per category or other similar slate nominees? Personally, I and the people who have put this together do not believe that is an acceptable long-term solution. We also ask that people can understand we're asking to put this through now so that next year, assuming EPH is in place and we've had a year of it, if it's apparent EPH isn't giving us the results we want, we have this already ready to be ratified and to be taken forward. Because again, time is of the essence. The more years we have of lots of no awards and large puppy presence on the ballot, the more damage we are taking to the awards. What is it that we are essentially doing? What we've aimed to do in spirit is to bring the no award test forward. You know, we are looking only to eject candidates that are seen as being on the long list by abusive process and that the vast majority of voters consider shouldn't be there. This is not about looking for edge cases of, you know, oh, I don't really like Doctor Who. This is about the committee of the whole standing up and saying, we do not wish to play this game. One of the features I would suggest of the last couple of years is that, you know, we are a fairly slow-moving democratic organisation and we're confronted with quite a fast-moving opponent who probably quite enjoys seeing us tying ourselves in knots. And hence the short title per War Games, you know, sometimes the only winning move is not to play. You know, we're trying to ask people to stand up as they did in the final ballot last year and say, we're not going to play this game. Lastly, I'm going to say two final things. First of all, I'm sure people will stand up and speak to, well, why didn't we consider other things? Because at first sight, 3SV does look like a very negative kind of thing. It's a blackball, effectively, against people. We understand that. We considered other options. We particularly considered the idea of sort of semi-final type voting, which has been promoted online. The challenge is, in our view, that asking people to do a ranked semi-final of 15 candidates in 15 categories is unrealistic. It would not be practical for the members or the administrators or the creators to put together such a large packet, for instance, to allow some kind of choice. And we're not asking people to provide a detailed consideration of, do I think I would like personally to vote for that as a my preference for a winner. Historically, people didn't put things below no award just because it wasn't their personal taste. They typically would put rank things they liked, and then they would maybe put no award or leave the rest blank. No award is there to say, we really don't think this is deserving of consideration, not just that we don't think it's deserving of winning. So lastly, you know, I've seen online a few people saying, we think the intent of the makers is X, Y, Z. And I want to be clear, the intent of the makers is that nominators should basically vote yes unless they have a specific objection. We're not expecting them to read all the works. This is a chance to say, that is abusive process. I absolutely would be no awarding that work. Thank you.
I saw the woman back there first, the speech against.
I'm Kate Pogg. Some of you may recognise my name. I don't care if you do or don't. I would like to point out that, as written, this proposal is for a vote of all the membership. Since some of the membership are committed, and I'm not naming names, but since some of the membership are highly committed to having works of their choice stay in and works that they dislike stay out, what precisely does this do to prevent a highly motivated, antithetical group from taking membership and then using this to knock out worthy candidates? What does this proposal do to enhance the reputation of the Hugo Awards? What does it do to increase the membership, which, given the popularity of science fiction as a whole and the increasing popularity with young people, should have a voting base more than double its current base? It should be wildly popular. And if there are thousands upon thousands of voters and thousands upon thousands of nominators, the ability of any one specific faction to dominate anything is massively diluted. Whereas this proposal is really going to expose the awards to even more likelihood of manipulation and do a great deal of damage, in my opinion, to the reputation of the Hugos as a whole, to the reputation of the Hugo Committee for Honesty, and to the potential future of the Hugo Awards.
Mr. McCarty, I saw you rise first, and I...
Speaking as an administrator, 3SV actually does something else that wasn't, I think, even intended that I find to be a great good. One of the hardest jobs that we have when we close the nominating ballot is determining everyone's eligibility because so much knowledge is needed for it. This essentially crowdsources people helping us figure out things that aren't eligible in a way that does not damage the reputation of the Hugos, which I find to be a great good and is of much bigger benefit than the small thing of setting up a second vote. On the idea of this engineering a place where it can be further, where it can cause further people to engineer the system, this requiring a majority of the people participating, it's inherently democratic. And if you have a group that is 50% plus one, then yes, you should get to say what's there, and I don't care who that group is.
I look at... Yeah. Yep.
This is a speech against.
Hyman Rosen. I sent in a proposed wording.
No, in the mic.
I sent in an exact wording of what I proposed to amend the resolution to the committee. I'm not sure if they got it. I just did it a few minutes ago. But my proposal is to keep the accept-reject voting as stated in this proposal. However, rejected entries are not removed from the finalists. What happens is that we lengthen the ballot so that from the list of the final 15, we keep...
Let the member finish, please.
We keep everything as a finalist from the first entry on the list through the fifth non-rejected entry. So if there are any rejected entries above that fifth, they also go on the final ballot. This way, no nominee, which would have otherwise made the final ballot, is removed from the final ballot, so everyone in the final voting can still vote for it. However, if the sense of the Worldcon membership is that some items are rejected, what happens is that we just lengthen the list to include further entries that are not rejected, and then, you know, people can vote or not vote as they choose. And I have a specific wording. I yield to the question.
Better to ask for a second and see if this motion is on. Yeah, is there a second for the motion?
Yep, we've got one over there.
Is that a second? Okay. The speaker will yield for a question.
Jeff Haas, 2A's, 1S.
Well, get it from your web.
Yeah.
When you're done.
My question is, so if
could you move the mic?
Graphic.
My question is, so if two semifinalists are rejected, then the number of finalists will be extended by two. Is that what you're looking to do?
Yes.
Thank you.
Possibly even more if the. If there is a not, if there are more rejected ones below, you know, above a non-rejected one.
Question. Thank you.
No, I have a question.
Yeah, yeah. Miss X's question. Please come.
I have a point of order, Mr. Chairman. Point of order.
Yes, it does.
Mr. Chairman, do we have actual text of this proposal that we can look at?
I was looking at my email while the speaker was speaking, and I don't personally have it. I don't know if any of the other members. There is unfortunately a delay with the con server.
If you like, I have it written in handwriting. I can read it.
Yeah,
right.
Thank you. Please bring that up, and we'll attempt to get this on the screen. The chair will read the text once he has it.
Can I go ahead and ask?
Yes, you can ask your question while we get it up on the screen.
Okay, I remain Rachel Axe, and the question is, and I apologize if you said this and I missed it because I was like typing and summarizing. If we extend the list, I'm trying to not like scream into the mic. If we extend the list for as you proposed, would the things that were rejected that are still on there be marked as having been rejected, or would it just be like glossed over?
I sent that in as part of my email. No. Once we finish producing the final ballot, the final ballot simply contains entries in no particular order. It's simply the list of nominees without any indication that they were rejected or not.
Okay, so it's basically just we can see that there's now 8 entries on this, and so obviously 3 of them were rejected. Let's try to play a game and figure out which 3 it was.
Or there was a tie for last place.
4 ties.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's okay. Thank you.
Miss Secor, for what purpose does the member rise? For the speaker? Please come to the microphone.
Not that this is likely, but in the case where the membership rejects the entirety of the long list, do we then move on to the next 15 people?
I have that sent in because I'm a programmer, so I think of edge cases. I defined the last accepted entry as either the 5th non-rejected entry, or if there isn't any, I think then just like the 5th entry on the list, or so you always get 5, assuming there are 5 nominees on the long list. I didn't cover that case.
All right, I wish to have a speaker against, but I understand that you.
Tammy has a speech against.
Tammy, do you want to speak? Okay, you don't need the. Do we want the text before we have a speech against?
Yes. Yes.
Tammy, could you come to the microphone a sec?
I'm trying to actually have us know what we're debating before we continue to debate it, but.
Switch the email and I saw you.
We should know what we're doing.
We're coming. We're going to move for a third committee. Give a speech saying that we're going to get a third committee. Mr. Chairman?
The chair, once he sits back down, the chair recognizes Mr. Eastlake for a motion on the amendment. It doesn't really matter.
It's not quite complete. I would like to move to refer the constitutional amendment with this pending amendment to it to a committee to report back tomorrow. And. If this motion to refer to committee is defeated, I think we should defeat this because it's just too complicated to try to get through today.
Second. Is there any, do we need to debate the motion to refer to committee?
No.
All right, all those in favor of referring the amendment to committee to report back tomorrow, please raise your hands. All right, hands down, all those opposed. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion is referred to committee. Mr. Rosen, I'm going to appoint you to the committee. Mr. Eastlake, do you mind if I appoint you to the committee?
No.
Mr. Eastlake, and they can appoint members. And Colin, yes.
I do not wish to
Okay. Okay. The two members can gain other members as they see fit, and they can tell me when they're going to meet. That brings us then to B.2.8, which is retrospective improvement. It's on page 24 of your agendas.
No, wait, what about, oh, right.
Yeah, that's right.
This motion has been split into three separate clauses. For what purpose does the member rise? Okay, please come up to the microphone.
Ruth Sachter, I'd like to move that we take up the third item first.
Second. I have a question. 3 point whatever three last, and then one and two?
No, first.
Right. Yeah, 3 point whatever three first, then one, then two?
Yeah.
Okay, just because if we're gonna make an order, we should make an order. All right, there was a second. Do we need to debate reordering?
No.
Thank you. So, all those in favor of starting with 3 point, I don't remember the number. 313.3 first, and then one, and then two. All right, hands down. All those opposed?
No.
All right, we're gonna start with 3.13.3. It has 4 minutes of debate. Mr. Eastlake, I believe you're the maker of the motion, so would you like to make a speech in favor?
Sure, I'll do it from here to save time. I believe in all cases, Worldcons that have printed you lists of Hugo Award winners have distinguished retrospective Hugo winners and indicated when they were voted, but there is no requirement that they do so, so they could, for example, print the 1939 retrospectives in their list as if they had been awarded in 1939. And this would simply impose the requirement that they note that they were retrospective and when they were voted.
Mr. Bloom, a speech against?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Kent Bloom, and I would like to move to convert this from a constitutional amendment to a resolution of the business meeting, as this level of detail instruction to the to Worldcons is essentially, in my opinion, wasted effort. You can't do anything about it by the time you even find out about it. It's already done. But I do agree that it's a good idea and should therefore be recommended.
Is there a second to? Is there any objection to changing this into a resolution?
Objection.
All right. Do we need to debate changing it into a resolution?
No.
No. Good. all those in favor of changing this clause into a resolution, raise your hands. All right. Hands down. All those opposed? I'm going to say the noes have it.
Division. Far from convinced.
There's a call for the division.
There's a large empty hole over there.
There were multiple calls.
Smoffish exercise.
Yeah,
Kevin Stanley, Mr. Chairman, normally I wouldn't raise the point of order in this case, but I think it will save more time. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask a show of hands of how many people wish for a division, noting that it takes 20% of the people present in the room to call for one.
All right, all those in favor of a division, for the record, I did believe the motion failed. All right, I don't think we have 20%. Therefore, the noes have it. This remains a constitutional amendment. Does anybody else wish to speak in favor of the clause? Is there, are there any objections? Seeing none, we're going to vote on 3.13.3. All those in favor, please raise your hands. All right, hands down. All those opposed? The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. 3.13.3 goes on to Worldcon 75. Now we're going to do 3.13.1. Don, do you want to give Any more, or? This also has 4 minutes of debate time.
And this is a very simple cleanup. It makes it less wordy. In that it doesn't give an explicit list of how many of the multiples of 25, it's just any multiple of 25 years later you can award a retrospective Hugo. It removes the clause about not having to include items that don't have sufficient nominees, because that's generally true of all Hugos. There's a general clause that does that. The only thing it really adds is that permits retrospective Hugos to be awarded if a Worldcon wishes to do so and is held the right year for the years where there was no Worldcon because of World War II. It seems to me just bizarre to be able to have retrospectives for 39, 40, and 41, but not have them for 42, 43, et cetera, until the Worldcons resumed after World War II.
Is there anyone wishing to speak against this motion? Seeing none, Mr. Shirt, for what purpose does the member write?
Whatever.
Yeah.
Not enough.
Who can be Fred? Who cares?
What?
You're Fred now.
I speak against this motion in the fact that who's left to remember who read really what was good in World War II? Let's face it, most of the people from that year are dead. Let's be honest. Getting this is getting a little ridiculous. Even this year's retrospectives, we're wondering, was it in, was it out? Who the hell knew what it was?
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor of the motion? The gentleman right here.
David Dyer Bennett. I found the retrospective Hugos this year much easier to nominate for than the current Hugos. With tools like ISFDB, it was easy to check out the names that were there, and I recognized most of them because I read them when I was a teenager. I was not so old that I was actually there when it was happening, but in fact, there still are people who know and care about that period, and I found it easier than the current ones, which is probably a criticism of my current reading. That's a separate issue.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak again? Ms. Helton.
David Dyer Bennett.
Yes.
Nice to meet you.
Stacy Helton. This text also removes the requirement that it be up to 100 years. This text allows it to be any exact multiple of 25 years, which means it could be 200, 250, 500 years down the road. I am extremely opposed to that. If they are no longer, if all of them are no longer alive, I do not see the point in honoring them at that point because they are not around to recognize the honor.
Can I get your name? Stacy.
For what purpose? Speech in favor?
Thank you.
You have 30 seconds.
Leanne Hildebrand. I just want to say that while I know there's a concern about whether or not the honorees are alive or dead or who's been reading them, that the Hugos exist as a larger cultural phenomenon within fandom, and we've included things like retro costuming and dancing, and all of those things are part of acknowledging our heritage of fandom, not just the small concern about whether or not there's someone alive to appreciate the award. That's why I'd like to see this expansion happen. Thank you.
Mr. Richards, for what purpose?
Oh, okay, that doesn't help.
Okay. How much time does he have? 7 seconds.
No, more than, no, more than a minute.
Okay, go ahead. I know who you are. I'll.
Mark Richards.
Thank you.
While I appreciate the concept of recognizing our heritage, I am of, I have mixed feelings about the retro Hugos to begin with. I really don't want to see them entrenched as a permanent part of the Hugos. Right now, as they are constituted, there is a sunset clause on them. Once we run through the cycle of 75 years, and then there's the cycle of 100 years, and then we're done.
Time has expired. I believe time has also virtually expired in favor of the motion. Yeah. Did somebody rise to Mr. Harris? Are you
that was basically most of what I had to say.
Are you making a motion to extend debate?
I'm in favor, but like that long, if there's a few seconds left.
7 seconds.
I can do it in 7 seconds. There are only about half a dozen years left that we haven't done, maybe 10 if we include the war years. We're basically going to be done in a few years anyway, because almost everybody who can do retros is doing them.
All right. Seeing as how debate time has expired, we will vote on the motion. This is on 3.13.1. All those in favor, please raise your hands. All right, hands down, all those opposed. The ayes appear to have it, the ayes do have it. We will move on to 3.13.2. This also has 4 minutes of debate time.
My name is Donald Eastlake. Sorry, I haven't been saying that each time. Possibly this one will be a little bit more controversial. But we only have a small debate time, so hey, we'll get through it one way or the other. So this adds the new concept of a category Hugo as opposed to a year Hugo. The year Hugos are run for a particular previous year where no Hugos were awarded using the current rules. This says that if in some previous year no award was given in a particular category, because no award won, so to speak, under the rules, then if Worldcon believes that there was something peculiar about that year and maybe no award shouldn't have won, and they think something particular should have won, they may, if there are a multiple of 25 after, and no previous Worldcon has done this yet, they may decide to run a category retrospective Hugo. And it's a little bit different because it would use the same definition of the category that had applied in the previous year when no award would won. Of course, no Worldcon is ever required to do this. And under the rules we've adopted, if they ever do this, then in the listing of the Hugos, it would say this category was retrospectively rewarded 25, 50, whatever years later. So I think it's a good idea. That's why I suggest it.
Come to the microphone.
Just a really quick question.
Could you state your name?
Daniel Rigo. Would this preclude consideration of nominees that were in years where there was no award, or are they precluded from future consideration?
I don't understand what that means. Nominations would be rerun for that category and year. Yeah, the old nominations would be completely open. Okay. Everybody who was nominated before could be nominated again,
Can
and
I
it could be
name?
That exactly the same Please. Final list would show up, or it could be different.
The chair will remind people you can't gain recognition while someone is speaking. So please don't stand. You're only weakening your legs. Yes, a speech against, or a speech in...
Proposed. Yes. David Wallace, I propose that we amend this by substituting 10 years for 25 years.
Is there a second? Seeing none. Mr. Gallo, for what purpose does the member rise?
We only have like 20 seconds for.
What?
We're only 20 seconds left on the floor side.
State your name.
Ben Yallo. I believe that this particular motion is completely inappropriate.
Take the microphone out of the...
I believe this motion is completely inappropriate. We do not judge the decisions made by the voters under any circumstances. We do not say that, I don't like Lord of Light, it shouldn't have won a Hugo, why don't we re-vote? No award is listed just like any other candidate, and if the voters choose to vote no award, we should not second guess them.
Ms. Olson, speech four.
You have 23 seconds.
Priscilla Olson, and from what I understand of this, that means so in 26 years, we can re-vote on Sasquan's no award or something like that. And if that's true, I think this is a gosh wow, fun, wonderful idea, because it sort of proves that maybe we'll all be around 25 years from now and be able to play.
So just for the fact that it's so wonderfully cool, we should do it.
Ms. Kovar, speech against?
It's quite simple.
Name.
Sorry, Elspeth Kovar. It's quite simple, no award. That category has been voted on. It doesn't get voted on again.
Mr. Stanley, for what purpose does the member...
Speech against?
There is 1 minute left.
There's 1 minute yet. There is no time left, yes. There's 1 minute left. And if that was...
Yes, 1 minute, yes.
Kevin Stanley, yeah, there's only time left for speeches against. Mr. Chairman, I respect Mr. Eastlake greatly and have worked with him before. However, this one I believe is a fatally flawed proposal, surely for administrative purposes. I believe it very difficult for a 25, 50, et cetera, hence Worldcon, to be able to recreate the administrative rules in place at the time that category existed. And therefore, to spare us the attempt to do so, I encourage a vote against this proposal.
Mr. Quinn, for what purpose does...
Speech again.
15 seconds.
You have 15 seconds.
I believe this is a good idea. I believe it's not the time to do this. We have 25 years before this actually would affect anything. We have plenty of time to get this proposal right. No, it's a speech against.
No, it's a speech against.
It's a speech against passing it now. It's a speech in favor of considering this in the future. That's the end.
All right, I'd like to put the question.
Yeah, we're out of time.
We're out of time, so we're going to... Mr. Korngold, for what purpose does the member rise?
I would like to move to amend this proposal, replacing 25 with 50.
Is there a second? Seeing none, we're going to vote on the underlying proposal. All those in favor of 3.13.2, please raise your hands. All right, hands down. All those opposed? The noes appear to have it. The noes have it. The motion fails. All right, it is currently 12:37. We have two items of business left to handle today. I would really, really like to get through them if the meeting will allow it. So we are going to move on to B.2.9 universal suffrage.
Look at your videographer.
Do we need a 2 minute timeout?
2 minutes. That was the edge.
Okay, we're going to recess.